Yeah, I could do it like this. This will work. You guys can still hear the music at this angle. You can hear me talking. Yeah. Okay. I should probably let people know this exists. This fun TV in the background. I'm thinking after I go through the tapes, maybe I'll do some of this. Play with these visuals. Now it's just blurry in the background for everybody, but okay. Here we go. Twitch.tv/Pacific Plaza. That's it. It's true. Okay. I think it's on Periscope. I should double check that. Wow. Big smart guy. Uh-oh. I'm having stuff drop. This mouse never works. I don't know why. We're going to look at this and make sure it's working. What? No Periscope. It's supposed to restream. Do I have to open up that stupid website? It says Periscope's online, there's people watching. You're lying to me just to get me to only stay on Twitch here. Okay, it's working. We got both. We got people over on Periscope. We got people on Twitch. Let me just see what the Periscope feed looks like. Make sure it's real. You can see some of the stuff over here that I got. Get soldering gear out of the way. Let's pull it in. Okay. What's up, sleep pattern? Let me actually go on stream manager so if we get any new folks jumping in here, we can acknowledge them. So, Dreamwolf, thank you for the follow a couple days ago when we were doing nothing. Life just works out like that. That's cool. Okay. Well, this is looking good. Right now in the background, we have some tracks from Oh Come All Ye Vapeful. We'll be talking about it later, so I figured I would just start off with some of the music. But wow, I got a stack today. I think I might have gone... This is bonus content. I think I might have gone more than 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh, no, here's 10. And then we got some bonus content, and we have new Pacific Plaza release. So, I'm gonna go into takeoff preview, because I know what I'm gonna look like. And free up my internet a little bit. We're ready to rock. Take a little sip of water here. Yummy, yummy, my tummy. Okay. Let's do this. Welcome to Tapes on Tuesday with Alex. I don't know if I'm going to keep that with Alex part. Tapes on Tuesday is just so catchy. But I'm going through 10 different releases. Almost all of them are cassettes. As I did last week, I have some special stuff that is non-cassette, but this is unique packaging. So the idea here is to pull things from my collection and just talk about them. Some of them are seasonally appropriate. Some of them are things I have strong attachments to. Some of them are vaporwave related. Some of them tell a continuing story. So if you haven't watched last week's episode, you can go back and watch that on Twitch. I'm hoping to upload it on YouTube. I don't really know how you rewatch stuff in Periscope. Is that possible? Maybe it is. I don't know, but whatever. So if you're having issues with the sound, or if the balance is not right, let me know. I'm still trying to get that worked out. I don't have any, like, in-ear monitor situation. And I'm trying to conserve resources on the computer, so I can't actually see what the stream looks like. But I am keeping up on Twitch chat, so if you're watching on Periscope, and you want to chat and talk about things that are going on, come on over to Twitch, twitch.tv/Pacific Plaza, and you can follow us, or you can subscribe. If you subscribe, you get special emojis. And I'll put some of those special emojis in the chat. If you watch for long enough on Twitch and you have an account, you will get channel points, and you can very quickly unlock sub emotes if you just watch the channel for a little while, because I try to lower the points as much as possible. So you could come over and you could grab a nice old jazz solo Glock. That's essentially what it is. That's what I like to call it. Or maybe these two other great emojis. Are they appearing on screen? I want to make sure my chat stuff is working. Okay. Chat is working. Yay! So we're going to get going here. I have vaporwave, non-vaporwave, punk, emo, and I have some stuff that was given to me by Crust Punks years ago. Hey, Mr. Mellow with the jazz solo. Whoa! I'm on a drum stool. It just lowered, which was sketchy as fuck. I don't want to die on Twitch. That's so sad. God. Okay. So here we go. I got a big old stack of stuff here, and I guess I'll start with the thing on top. Start with some vaporwave. Let's pull up the track here. Well, not the track, the EP. So this is an EP called Daytime Kicks, and it is by Rez. This is a super sick release that came out on Midnight Moon, and I just love this EP. So when I saw this on Discogs sometime in the last couple months, I was like, I should pick this up, because I never had a chance to buy this when it originally came out, because it came out and sold out before I got in the scene. And stuff like that is kind of why I don't like to hype Pacific Plaza stuff selling out too much. Because, like, I wish I had been able to buy this back in the day. Luckily, the price was pretty low on it, even though Midnight Moon Tapes was, like, a pretty hoppin' label during its time. The resale value on an EP like this with only 4 songs has gone down. And so I was able to purchase this for the price of basically just buying a normal tape release that was, like, I think, like, $8 or $9 probably. So just like a normal Pacific Plaza release. And you know, this is nice quality. Like Midnight Moon made really cool shit. Midnight Moon was a super sick label. It looks like here on their Bandcamp, they stopped at the beginning, first half of 2018. But I think they started way back in like 2015 or 16. Definitely 2015, because this is a late 2015 release. October 30th, 2015. And let me put it on the background. So good. Such a good EP. Yeah, that's a bit of what it sounds like. That's the first track. And, you know, Midnight Moon Tapes did pretty good stuff back in the day. I have a few of their tapes. They're a label that I kind of want to collect from now in retrospect. I don't know how many people are really still into that label, but they always made cool stuff. They put out a lot of great releases. They're actually based in Riverside. And that was always kind of cool for me as a Southern California person, that they were also Southern California people, maybe at the University of Riverside, from what I noticed on like, address stuff I saw back in the day. But yeah, this is just the whole EP on both sides, four songs. Your Ruby and Red tape. This is a great reddish-pinkish color that a lot of people use, and I really enjoy this color shell. We've done at least three or four different releases on Pacific Plaza with this color shell. And they definitely did their best to match the color here, which is pretty nice. And it's interesting, this is on some kind of semi-gloss or photo sort of stock. It's definitely pre-cut label, so you don't have like awkward shapes on your inside. You can see when people cut their own labels, because usually the inside is a bit wonky and it's not super straight. It has, you know, your Kiss cut, but classic problem that even I have to this day, where you get slight overlaps because printers are always slightly miscalibrated. No printer is really perfect to your template. That's why bleed is important, but a lot of cassette labels are not sold with bleed on the top and bottom. So this is a problem I encounter a lot as well, and I feel for them. For myself, I actually get out a X-Acto knife, usually a panel, like a synth panel, and then I shave off this little part here that is clearly not meant to be on this. But not everyone can do that. Not everyone has that time and dedication. So I get it. But it's nice to have this. This is a really good classic, like 2015 low-key release. Just a simple double-sided J-card. Really cool artwork, really nice like renders and like font choice. Midnight Moon was always pretty on point with their like, you know, physicals aesthetic. It's interesting, the case is definitely worn. Someone had this in their collection for a while, or maybe it went to a couple different collections, who knows. But four tracks, Daytime Kicks, Business Buzzed, Walkman, and Lookin' Friday. It's fantastic. I wish I could reissue this EP. You know, I don't really know Active Midnight Moon Tapes is. I don't really know who Rez is. I thought they were someone that they're not at one point, but I thought they were still around. But I'm not sure if they're even still around. They did some collab albums with Oscar back in the day, and I'm not sure if he had a Bedlam Tapes release or not, but definitely had this Midnight Moon Tapes release. Midnight Moon 9. So their 9th release was in October of 2015, over 5 years ago. Man, Vaporwave is so sick. But yeah, I really like this tape, really like Midnight Moon as a label, and I kind of like, if I had more money, I would totally be collecting Midnight Moon right now, because there's some of their more low-key releases you can pick up for pretty cheap on Discogs, or people sometimes sell in the VCC. But awesome EP, it'd be cool to reissue this, and also do a mini CD version. Do I ever archive these digitally for my own purposes? No, not really. There was one point in college I tried to digitize 7-inches, especially weird 7-inches I couldn't find and stuff I thought I might upload to like a torrent site, but no, not really. Midnight Moon Tapes is not one of those vaporwaves that disappeared and then destroyed their catalog. Like, their stuff is still up there, and Rez Daytime Picks is still traded on SoulSeek, and you can still find on Spotify, or not on Spotify, on Bandcamp, on the artist's own Bandcamp. I believe they still left their Bandcamp up there. So, this is still out there, easy to find on Bandcamp. So, no need to worry about archiving this. This is probably on Vapor Memory. I wouldn't be surprised, because there wasn't as much to put on Vapor Memory in 2015, so a lot of labels stuff did make it up there. What I thought was kind of cute is, this is a little piece of paper that says that this is number 6 out of 25. So this is a limited edition tape out of 25 tapes. I believe this EP had two editions. I think there were two different editions of it that I remember seeing on Bandcamp. Can't be 100% sure without actually looking up on Discogs, but I have a feeling this might have only got one pressing. So this is really cool to have. I actually really love this EP and it sounds awesome. Yeah, luckily this label did not eat its own tail. Midnight Moon just exists there in the vapor ether, and more people should really give them cred for doing, like, super sick releases. Is this? No, that's not a Midnight Moon release. But, yeah. We re-listened almost 3/4 of this EP, which is awesome. Should I? I got my like vapor stack and my non-vapor stack. I'm gonna get in all the Christmas stuff in the second half on its own. So maybe I'll continue on the vapor stack for a while here. Gosh, I need to stop putting my foot on this thing. I'm gonna die. Let's continue with some vapor here. We have Biosphere by Cobalt Road and Stack Overflow. Holy fuck. This is one of my favorite albums of all time. Bye bye other music. Here comes some new music. I've actually thrown tracks from this album into a few DJ sets. Like, I really love it that much that I've found ways to work these tracks into the music that I like to play out, because there's so many varying tempos and different feelings on it. It works great with vapor trap stuff. It worked great with sort of the dream punky vibe I went for the villain set. And, like, this album is so good. I actually also had, forget who reviewed it, when I did an exchange with Private Suite, where we all exchanged albums and we reviewed each other's album picks. But I picked this one for whoever did it. I want to say Rich did it? Pony Danza? PHLSFO? Yeah, and I had him do this tape. This is Biosphere. Cobalt Road and Stack Overflow. And you know why I feel like this tape's kind of a bit related to this Midnight Moon tape? Is Stack Overflow had a bunch of releases on Midnight Moon. I actually have one of those. Maybe I should have got that one out. Maybe we'll do that next time. But yeah, Stack had a couple of releases on that label, and they're all stuff I want to collect. But this, I believe this is the second edition. No, this is first edition. Okay, cool. So yeah, this is the first edition version of the tape. There was a second edition version that actually has different artwork for the cassette, but this artwork is very similar to the digital artwork, and the digital artwork for this album is some of the most perfectly encapsulated, like, vaporwave aesthetic that doesn't rely on cliche. So even you can see on this, kind of, like, it has this mesh as opposed to a checker pattern, and the way it kind of bends and flows is super cool. I've definitely tried to emulate that with some of my checker patterns by making my checker patterns bend and flow in artwork. It's got these like little bubbles of images, and all the images just like add up to all these different vibes each track brings on the album, and it's fantastic. It's also got like a bit of a VHS render to it, and you can see that in the original artwork as well. And in the very background, there's kind of like tropical water park resort vibes. I don't know, it's so hard to like put to words all the awesome shit that this artwork and this tape brings. But go check out the digital one, and the border itself with the gradient on the border is just fantastic. Like, very inspiring design. Inside, a bit of a letdown personally, I think, compared to the outside and the artwork. But hey, can't win them all. Tape, great color, beach, desert, love it. Looks perfect, nice and simple. This is just one of the best vaporwave albums of all time. This was the 6th release, wow, on Bedlam Tapes. And yeah, I believe this is the first edition. I thought about trying to pick up the other edition, which has black tape and alternate artwork. But I'm not that crazy yet. What? There was a CD version of this? Holy. I didn't even know there was a CD version of this. Okay, if anyone finds a CD version of this album, please send it to me or show me where I can buy it, because I would love a version of this on CD. This is an album that I would eventually want to collect all the versions of. And motherfucker, I would put this on vinyl in a second. Like, fortunately, I think Cobalt Road's moved on from his vapor trap stuff. Stack still posts some music, but not as common. It's a little more poppy now. But both great artists, both still active, both kind of doing something a little bit different than what was happening in this era. But this is a great album, Biosphere, by Cobalt Road and Stack Overflow, released on Bedlam Tapes. Back, wow, February 2016. cassette design by Marcus32X. Wonderful. So that's number two. I need to take a little vape break here. Listen to a little more of this. This track is Oasis. I listen to this track. It reminds me of the video game Age of Empires and the map Oasis. So I'm going to turn my mic off so I can listen to it with you guys for a bit. One of the best collab albums of all time. That's one of the other things that's really remarkable about this, is it's a collab album. Like, it comes together so well, and there's even, like, features on it and stuff. Can't say enough good things about Biosphere. But now I think is the time where we move into weirder stuff. We'll do a bit of a transition here. I don't know if I can find... Yes, I can find it. This might exist. Okay, this next release, wow. You guys are gonna not know what the fuck this is at all, and I honestly barely even know what the fuck this is at all. So this is a cassette that I bought when I went to China in 2013. And I bought this tape at an indie record store. I went to a couple different indie record stores in Beijing when I was there, and I made like a whole map for myself and all the addresses and shit so I could find them. I pretty much walked from our hotel, so I was in China doing Model UN, and there was a company in China paying for us to go there and basically help them run their conference. And they would do this for a lot of college students throughout, you know, America, and we had some Europeans there also. And basically, we had this hotel where we walked from the hotel over to Tiananmen Square, which, you know, that's not what they want you to think of it as, but Tiananmen Square is there along with the grave of Mao Zedong and like the Forbidden City. And it's really cool, really interesting. And we walked around that area, saw some of the touristy stuff, went to some other temples nearby, and then my friends bounced and I was like, I am going to go find these record stores. And they were in a very specific part of town, and there was also music venues in that part of town, which they call live houses. And I went to like three or four different record stores and spent about like 6 or 7 hours basically going through them trying to find vinyl, which I didn't really find any. Found a lot of CDs, and I bought a ton of CDs when I was in China. And then I found this one tape. All the other tapes I found were like American music and stuff where they like cut out a corner of it. Basically what they call cutouts, but they were records and tapes that were extras that they threw away because they weren't worth keeping in America because no one was gonna like buy them because they were shit like Metallica where they made like way too many of them and they couldn't actually sell that many. So I went to China and this was the only cassette tape I found when I went to the indie record stores. And let's put on some of the music. I won't tell you what it sounds like yet. The Bandcamp is gbjd.bandcamp.com. And as of a couple years ago, it was still up there. Let's see if it still exists. This is really anticlimactic right now. It's still there. Yes! And there's like not much on it. Apparently they ran this like label for a very short amount of time, but the album's here. I'm gonna put it on. The tape's recorded really terribly. So when I listened to this tape originally on my tape player, I was like, there's so much noise. This is kind of crazy. There's a ton of like hiss. And if I remember correctly, this is pretty much just a noise album.
Yeah.
yeah, you kind of get an idea of what this is. This is noise. It's a noise act. It's definitely a noise band, because you can hear some drums and bass and stuff thrashing in the background. So this is a noise band from China. And on the band camp, it actually says it's called Xiao Hong and Xiao Xiao Hong. That's the band name. Titles in Chinese, I haven't looked it up in years, so I don't know what it is. But this was released in May 2013, so I literally bought this tape like 2 months after it came out. I was in China late July, early August 2013. And, it's pretty nuts. So the only tape I found was a noise tape, really weird, from an underground Chinese noise band that had gotten around the firewall to put their shit on Bandcamp, because you can't just access Bandcamp in China. You have to get a VPN, you have to go around the firewall to use Bandcamp. And this was a cool find. I found some 7 inches. I didn't find any 12 inch vinyl. I should correct myself from earlier. And I found a lot of CDs. But this tape was the only one I found. This looks like it was just a normal tape from a store. Whatever you day means. Like, I don't know where they got this, but these labels were, I don't know if they put them on themselves or what. I don't remember it being so dirty when I bought it. It's been through a lot. It's been to a couple different warehouses I lived in, and obviously got in 2013, so it's seen a lot of action. It's obviously traveled across the ocean. And I'm not sure if this fading is me, or if it's falling apart, or if it's just shit quality. But this is clearly stamped on here. So they stamp this stuff on each side. J cards are pretty low key. I mean, this artwork, obviously, this is chopping your finger off. It makes sense for a noise album. But they didn't score it. The ink coverage is pretty low because obviously it started cracking when they folded it. This tape case, like, it's really, really angular. Like, it's not much curve to it. Whereas a lot of American Norelco cases, they have a lot of curve to them. As you can see, this case has a lot more curve to it. So, I don't know, it was a really interesting find. I bought this in China, literally, I guess months after it came out. I didn't really realize that at the time. And it's got inside stuff. One of the songs is called Josh Feta. One of them's called Mamon Tov. One called Doctor and Loop. Here, there's some number here. It says Psychic Kong Beijing. I don't know. They have a Dubon website, which a lot of Chinese bands have Dubon websites. I discovered Chinese football on a Dubon website. And, yeah. This is just a really cool tape to have in my collection. This is something really special I was able to acquire in Beijing, China in 2013. The year it came out. Super trippy. When I was on that trip in China, I went to a couple different record stores. I met this one guy who went by the name Noodle. When you asked him for an English name, it was Noodle. He was really cool, really nice guy. I also was at a reggae bar for a while where they had some reggae records, which was really interesting, but it was all Western reggae, so I was like, this really isn't that exciting for me to buy, except for one CD that was by a Chinese reggae band, and I was like, I'll buy it. I also went to Mao Live House. I forget what number or location, but I went in there, and it was empty in the middle of the day, but the doors were just unlocked and open. So I went into this Chinese music venue and kind of checked it out. Every venue in China has a back line of gear, because most people can't afford or don't have the space to own a ton of gear in big cities. And I kind of just walked around the whole place, and like no one was there, so no one stopped me. And when finally I saw someone, I was like, hey, I want to buy a t-shirt. And so I bought a t-shirt from Mao Live House, even though I didn't get to see a show. And as I was leaving, there was a band loading in, which was kind of cool to see a bunch of like Chinese indie rock punk kids like getting ready for their show that night that I unfortunately could not make it back to because I had to go to an official business dinner that evening. Man, I am making my life so hard here. Okay. But yeah, I bought this tape in China. And it's apparently by Xiao Hong and Xiao Xiao Hong. Still no idea what the title is. I'm not going to bother to translate it. You can look it up if you want. But very cool tape. Very weird noise tape. I don't think I have anything else noise related. I think this is where we go into the non-vaporwave, non-noise segment of stuff. And we talk about things I really enjoy, like indie rock, emo, power pop, and like soft rock, soft pop, sort of like one of the other albums I talked about last week, Shaggy Sample. There's this tape by Ihe, which is called Unlimited Cool Drinks. And I love this tape. I have a very special connection to this tape in multiple ways. So, one thing that's tricky about this tape is I believe it was taken off of Bandcamp. I think it was up for a while when the tape was sold, but I'm not sure it's there anymore. So, Iji is spelled I-J-I. Oh, it's still there. Yes. Nice, nice, nice. Oh, and look at this. This is another tape I bought in 2013. Oh, yeah, I know why I bought this in 2013. Cool. Let's start off with an amazing song called Little Pictures. This is the first song on the tape. This is from Unlimited Cool Drinks by Iji. So yeah, just like really catchy, fun DIY pop music. I love this band. Iji is amazing. Everyone should go listen to Iji. They have a ton of albums, a ton of cool stuff, and it's still really DIY, really hands-on. What is not for sale, not for M? Stand on my shirt. Not for sale, and it's supposed to be NFT, not for trade. That's what it stands for. Not for sale, not for trade. Which, none of these tapes are for sale or for trade. So, that does apply to the situation. Anyways, back to Iji. Iji is a Seattle-based band. He was originally in Phoenix, Arizona, and I kind of found out about Iji through people in the Phoenix DIY scene, but also really experienced them as a member of the Seattle DIY scene, which they still are. They still play a ton of shows in Seattle. And they've actually been opening for bands like Frankie Cosmos and stuff in their last couple tours before the pandemic hit. And this is just, like, such a good band. A lot of it's home recorded. This EP is very specifically home recorded because this was kind of an EP in between albums, but it still has 8 songs on it. 8 amazing pop songs on it. And I bought this tape on tour, I believe. One of the special things about Iji is, like, them and a lot of their friends who are also on that seasonal splits box set I showed last episode really introduced me to DIY music, really introduced me to leftist political culture. And, like, even in some of these songs, there's themes that are, like, nonconformist and very much against, like, the kind of misogynist and patriarchal culture that, like, we all kind of exist in and try to, like, break down. And there's so many different, like, cool things in here. And when I'm saying here, I mean, like, in the Iji catalog that I think a lot of people could pick up on. Even their super old, like, you know, herky-jerky DIY, like, pop albums, all the way to their really well-produced recent album, like, Whatever Will Happen, and their new self-titled album that came out in March. Like, there's something to love about Iji, and, like, their musical style inspires me and my band, the Stereo Soul Movement. So if you heard us, you maybe might understand the correlation between these two bands. But I've booked a couple shows for Iji over the years. I've seen them play in the Bay Area. I've seen them play in Seattle. I've seen them play in Orange County. I've seen them play in Phoenix. Like, I'm just, like, so thankful I've run into this band and been inspired by them, and especially their front person, Zach Burba, over the years. And even met Zach's parents and stayed at Zach's parents' house once. Like, super cool. And stayed at one of the houses Zach lived in Seattle, which, New Crompton, which is in the U District. There's actually the next song on this EP, which I'll go to right now, is called Magic Lanes, which was another DIY punk house and show venue that was in the U District up until recently. I'm not sure if it's there anymore. But what's cool about this album is it has little references to other DIY bands who were kind of from that same scene they were into and the same scene I kind of came up in. And so some of them are kind of like deep stuff that you wouldn't get unless you're friends with these people, but like stuff on Magic Lanes, there's a bunch of references, but specifically to track 5, OK Performance OK, is talking about the experience of watching this band called OK Vancouver OK, who I had seen live and was super impressed by, and I own one of their tapes that are just like super amazing. And then there's another song called Johnny B. Tristan, which is about Tristan, the front person of the band Dog Breath, which is an Arizona band, now Seattle band, who's super amazing. And Tristan also plays in, what's that, like, drone noise band? I can't remember. Earth. He plays in Earth now, also. So, crazy connections to the Seattle music scene and, like, larger DIY punk sphere that's existed and really was kind of birthed out of Pacific Northwest in like the early to mid 80s, especially around like K Records and Sub Pop. But it's so good. He later re-recorded some of these songs that ended up on I think Whatever Will Happen and Bubble. But I just love the lo-fi-ness and the home-recordedness of a lot of these tracks. And I keep talking about this for a long time because there's still like more sick stuff about this that like is super relevant to my life and like things that have changed me since 2013 when I got this tape at an Ihi show. I actually met Zach from Ihi outside of a show I helped book in 2014 at a venue that was just an abandoned hair salon in downtown Santa Ana. And he was touring with a band called Mandarin Dynasty at the time. I thought about getting one of their tapes out for this, but I decided to just go with this one instead. And at the time, he had a 4-pack of Topo Chico, which is the drink on the cover of this album. And he was like, you should try this. And that was the night I learned of the magic of Topo Chico. And ever since 2014, after seeing this on the cover and then seeing him having it and him offering it to me, I've been a Topo Chico fanatic since that day. So thanks to this cover and the person behind this band, Zach Verba, I am the Topo Chico sparkling water connoisseur that I am now. And you know what's funny? If you go on the inside, a hand-drawn LaCroix can, drawn by the artist. This is Zach's artwork. And yeah, awesome. I mean, so funny. LaCroix and Topo Chico in one J card. Clearly printed at home J card. Zach definitely made these tapes himself. Stamped his Ihi stamp that he probably hand carved out of an eraser on this. Just a wonderful piece to have. Something really cool. Can't even really put a value on it. I mean, so many good songs. I'm going to skip to Hard to Wait because this is probably my favorite song on the whole tape. And he later re-recorded this and actually put a live string quartet on the re-recorded version of it. Oh, man. Steadfastly DIY affair. Wonderful band, wonderful album. Everyone should go check out Ihi. And you can even check out their new self-titled Ihi album. Songs we know and some we don't. I want to listen. Oh, you know what I was going to do? No, here we go. So what I love about Zach and people like Zach doing the home recording and like playing all the instruments kind of thing and getting help from friends when needed, here is the credits for this tape. All instruments recorded by Zach except the Little Pictures Band, which include Aaron Burgey from Megabog playing drums and singing. Will Murdoch. Oh, I forget what bands he had. On synth, Matt Bachman on bass. Matt Bachman plays in Big Thief, and he also plays in Megabog. On the Hard to Wait band, you had Tristan, who's in Dog Breath, Tyler Broderick there in Diners, and Mitch Kearney, who's that band Mitch was in? I can't remember right now. And then the instruments that Zach played on here. Here's the full list of instruments Zach played. Electric guitar, electric bass, drums, clave, conga, shaker, tambourine, Alesis HR-16 drum machine, Korg Poly 800, Linn drum machine, Art Multiverb LTX, alto saxophone, Omnicord, Akai AX-60, harmonica, classical guitar, acoustic guitar. And the album is dedicated to sparkling water drinkers of the world. I mean, perfect. Amazing, amazing EP. Can't say enough good things about it. I want to listen to some of the song with you guys right now.
Across the table, over the sea, I will wait. Isn't it a drifting dream? Can real love stay permanent and free? For us to live, for songs to stay true, I wanna listen good. Cause it's hard.
So good. So fantastic. Y'all should really get into Hee Hee. Really. So we're going to stay in a little bit of the poppy zone here. And we're going to move on to this is another EP, actually. But it was kind of more released as like a promo tape. Not quite a demo. It is really like fully formed. Tracks recorded in a studio, but it is by a band called Casual Friday. Casual Friday is an awesome band that does not exist anymore. They changed their name and then they got COVID-ed, so they didn't really get to play many new shows under their new name, and I don't know what even happened to the album they were working on, unfortunately. Doggo, come on. Oh my god, these dogs. I don't believe, this version of these songs are not available online, or not available on Bandcamp anymore. I think they may be available on YouTube, maybe on Spotify, but most of these tracks made it onto their album called Weekend Forever. And Casual Friday put out this awesome album called Weekend Forever in 2017, and it had like a super long release cycle, unfortunately, which kind of killed the momentum when this album and this band really could have just like blown up. I mean, they were really popular locally and they played a lot of really great shows with cool bands and opened for bigger bands like Mom Jeans and stuff later, but really I don't think it lived up to its full potential. And then they kind of like moved on and they got into more like jammy music and more like Built to Spill as opposed to like Weezer. So if you like Weezer, you will like this band, no doubt. But I can't play the one song I really want to play off this called Bugs. Bugs was the only track you could only find on here. And Always, actually. But Bugs was such a fucking great track. Man, why can't they just put the dogs inside? These dogs have been barking like all day. And they had just stopped before I started the stream. And so I was like, cool. They stopped. I don't know. They've had these dogs for years. I don't know why they can't make them happy. To make them happy. They're dogs. Anyway, I'm going to play the song FOMO because that is on this tape and it also made it onto their album, Weekend Forever. It's like when I start talking, they bark more. Ridiculous. So this track is called FOMO. And these guys are like a power pop band. They're so fantastic. And I want to listen along to them. For the past 3 months, they're thinking, what a schmuck. I am done. I need out. I need out. So I can see the world in all of it. Thank you. Yeah, you would have thought they were Weezer. I don't blame you. But yeah, this song, just so good. The next song that's coming up is called California. There was also a cassette single of that, which I have. But yeah, this is like the best parts of Weezer, and it's not like weird Rivers Cuomo being creepy. But yeah, the tape was super simple. I don't remember when or why I acquired this tape. Maybe I just got it from Open Door Records, which is a record label run by a friend of mine named Dan and his brother Ozzy. But Dan, I think, is mostly the one doing it now. And Dan is still running Open Door. They're still putting stuff out. In fact, they might have put out stuff by indie bands that you might have heard of or enjoy. And some people that are kind of blowing up, like Beach Bunny. What's kind of funny about this tape, if you look at this, there's a fuckload of tape in here. These are really long tapes, actually, and there's only 4 songs on it. I don't know if it keeps playing the EP over and over or not, but, like, yeah, this was just kind of done to be, like, a bit of a promo release. I don't know why they went with the black-backed tapes, probably to hide the fact there's no labels on them. This is, like, almost like computer paper printed with a nice-ish printer, but not really. Not scored. You could still see the lines that they were supposed to cut on here. Just classic, like, handmade fucking DIY shit. And, you know, I don't mind. It really takes me back. I met these guys in 2014. They were playing in a different band called Kuroshi Boy. Kuroshi Boy is also super sick. They're a little more like Get Up Kids or Saves the Day. And they evolved into this more mature power pop Weezer Ozma kind of sound. And, I believe you can find this EP online anymore, but the album, Weekend Forever, was really good. I'm not sure if there's any copies of the pressing left, but the pressing looked really great, and it has a seafoam color for the vinyl. And yeah, Casual Friday was a great band. Hope Zach and Vaughn, like, keep working on their new project and actually bring it to fruition, but, you know, Zach's been doing a lot of videos for people, and been doing videos for bands you may or may not have heard of, so they're still staying active. They've done some touring and roadieing for friends of theirs who are blowing up a little more. Like, Just Friends and stuff. So, Casual Friday. Great band. Interesting tape. Not gonna be able to find this anywhere. Can't even find some of these songs anywhere. And moving on to more emo punk adjacent stuff. This is not stuff that sounds like Weezer, but this does sound like pop punk emo bands, and this is a very Southern California 2010 to 14, 15 kind of sound, before this kind of era of Casual Friday, even though these bands did play together and these people were friends, and in fact, the drummer of Tough Stuff played in Casual Friday for a while in one of their later iterations, and still plays in a band with some of these guys, but one funny note about Casual Friday, their drummer, Sam, is left-handed. And he plays in a band with some people that are the children of the folks from a Red Cross. Crazy LA punk connections. Yeah. Anyway, on to Tough Stuff. I wonder if their Bandcamp exists anymore. These guys all hella moved on from music, basically. Except for one of their later joining members, Rain. Rain is still doing his own little thing on the side called Matt Rainier. But this is the College EP by Tough Stuff. It was also released as a 7-inch. And it was four songs, 5 on the tape version. Oh, no, they just numbered it weird. Interesting. Okay, well, you know what? Let me play one of the songs. These are a little more rough than you'd expect, I think. The lo-fi and the, like, yelpy vocals were really en vogue for the SoCal emo scene and the emo revival scene at the time. And this drum stool is failing me again.
I'm tired of the way you're telling me I lost me.
I love this type of drum beat right here. So good. So yeah, tough stuff. These guys were friends of mine. They were actually in the SoCal emo scene before I was, and I met them when I came back from college. So it's funny that this tape is called College. But it is released in an Arigato pack. This was like a popular thing to do for a while in the late 2000s, early 2010s. Was to buy one of these, you could print on it yourself, you could screen print on it, or in the case of this tape, you could just slather it in paint on all sides. Which is what this label did. And this label was called Tuesday Tapes. Ah, now we know why I chose this. Tuesday Tapes was run by someone that I mentioned in my last episode, the person who did the lettering and the artwork for that comp on my label. Their name's Andy. And they had a label called Tuesday Tapes. This was the first release, and it was for Tough Stuff. This is 15 out of 25. They glued a picture on the inside, and yes, it is like spray painted and like painted over with just so many layers of paint. It's ridiculous. And then they cut and paste all this stuff on here. In fact, I think all the different tapes might be different. I'm not 100% sure on that. These weren't sold on Bandcamp. They were only sold on like a big cartel or something like that. And yeah, this is obviously ultra handmade. Even on the tape here, just drawn on. Very cool shell color. I wish I could still get a transparent yellow shell like this. This is a fucking sick color. I really like it. And yeah, you can hear it in the background. It's kind of like short, pop-punky emo songs. And this band was so much fun live. We all used to get fucking lit to this band. People would be moshing and crowd surfing and all sorts of crazy stuff. In fact, this next song, I think, yeah, it's called High. I'm gonna listen to it here. This one, we would go fucking off for this song, circa 2014-15. Got that surfy vibe to it. It feels very California. And Tough Stuff, awesome band. They had also extreme issues with their debut album release that got pushed back like over a year, even longer than Cattle Cries got pushed back. I think the release show ended up being like 2016 for this album. Man, we're dropping frames, that sucks. Yeah, so their album release show didn't end up happening until like 2016 or something. By that point, a bunch of the band members kind of moved on or were starting new projects. One of them became a teacher and sold all of his music gear. And yeah, the album taking forever to come out was kind of the nail in the coffin for this band. And that was a problem for bands, especially small indie bands, DIY bands, circa 2012 to 2015, because plants were super backed up, the vinyl boom was in full swing. Tapes were not cutting it for some of these bands that were getting popular finally, and so they wanted to press bigger things and they couldn't because of the issues with plants being so backed up and there being so few plants. Now there's so many plants, and now they'll do small runs, small presses, but back then, a band like Tough Stuff couldn't just do 100 records or 50 records. They had to do like 500 records. In fact, their first 7-inch, which was of this, and it did sell out, had over 500 copies. And some of them were on color, most of them were on black. And I think I have one of those in my collection. I'd have to go look through it, but I'm pretty sure that I bought that. So yes, that is Tough Stuff, an emo band from Orange County, California, Orange County, Long Beach, and they were released on Tuesday Tapes for this first release. Very similar name, of course. Whew, so we're about an hour in. I have a good chunk of vaporwave here saved for the Christmas section. Get some bonus content, a new Pacific Plaza thing to show off. And then I have a visual setup back here that I haven't really dug into much yet, although I did reset one of the videos. Maybe I'll play around with that. I don't have a capture card, but I can just point the camera at it and go wild. So we'll see. We'll see if that works out. Windows 29B, thanks for the follow. That was a while ago, but, you know, thanks, bro. So here we go. We have Christmas Vaporwave. And I'm just going to go to the Pacific Plaza stuff. Yeah, let's just go back to Come All You Vapeful. Because I will get to that. I'll do that last. I'll start with the tapes. Actually, no. I will not do that. I will go to the first Christmas comp. We'll start at the beginning. A very good place to start. When you read, you begin with. Scrolly scroll scroll. Yes. Oh, this starts with a Streamcatcher song. It's so good. Before Streamcatcher blew up. Awesome song. So Pacific Plaza. It's a Vaporwave Christmas. Our first Christmas compilation. Released in 2018 originally. And it was digital, and there was a first run of tapes. Those tapes were clear. They were clear green tapes. Dark green. And, you know, I was looking through my collection shit recently, and I couldn't find the first edition. This is a second edition tape. This is a tape that will eventually be for sale, in fact, because I have a limited amount of these left, and they're going to go up for sale on Friday when I do my Christmas overstock sale. But this is the Christmas EP we did. My first, like, kind of big compilation I coordinated myself, and I think brought a lot of attention to the label. It was pretty awesome doing this. I was really stoked on it. I've done a Christmas EP or album every year for 10 years now. I started doing it right at the end of high school, beginning of college, just recording my own and doing my own releases for years and years and years. 1 year I did a Pacific Nature Christmas comp. I've done my own Vaporwave Christmas EP in 2017. That was what I did for my Christmas release in 2017. 2016 was a collaboration between me and different friends in the music scene, doing like acoustic folk stuff. Gosh, I could just go all the way back to 2009 when I did my first one, which is super Sufjan Stevens ripoff. But this technically would have been the 8th thing I had done. The volume 8 of me releasing Christmas stuff every year. And yeah, I made the artwork for this. I put the font and did all the design. And then the inside of this, the artwork was submitted by Cosmopack, and I couldn't really use this for the front design, and I just decided to kind of go with my own thing. But I did put it on the inside, and I added the names of all the people who were on it, which I thought was kind of nice. Added the release number, and it turned out pretty well. So these actually came out for the first time in 2018, different color shell. I reissued it last year in 2019 with these solid green shells. And I redid the sticker for it. I did a new edit of the sticker. This is the same sort of sticker I had on the original version as well. But this one was much cleaner, had a lot less errors, a lot less of the problems like what I was pointing out on the Rez Daytime Kicks cassette. I got rid of some of those problems when I redid this last year. I tried to step it up and make it a little nicer. So these reissues are actually nicer than the original version that came out. But great songs on it, cool stuff. I'm really hoping I get great submissions for our Christmas compilation this year. Because that one's going to be open submission again. And the one we did last year was actually not open submission. Yeah, Mist, you have got like all the Christmas shit. Although I don't know if you have these two Christmas things I have. Oh, I'm gonna have to run up because I forgot one of the things that I have. But I do have the Contemporary Tapes Christmas album. I ended up buying it off of Power Lunch, of all people. I think it cost more when I bought it from Power Lunch than it originally did on the label, and I missed out on the drop, and he didn't offer label or he didn't offer artist copies to anyone beforehand. Contemporary Tapes. But yeah, in mine, I actually offered it to the artist that I would send them all tapes, and the ones that wanted it did get it. And if there are artists who were on these tapes that haven't gotten one since, you should let me know now, like before Friday, because I will not have any more extras after Friday. But if you get to me before Friday, then I can actually probably help you. So, hit me up if you were on this and you don't have one. They came with buttons. I made those buttons out of an actual wrapping paper, so they're kind of shiny and foily and cool. Every one of these came with a button. And the candy cane. I love including candy canes. I actually bought some for this year's Christmas stuff I'm sending out. And I'm going to try and put them in almost any package that goes out around the holidays starting now in December. So, this is the original Pacific Plaza. It's a Vaporwave Christmas compilation, our very first one. And you can buy some of these extra tapes on Friday. They're going to get dropped with the overstock of other Christmas stuff. And this Twin Pines tape. Saturn Car concept album? That was a Christmas album, technically? Interesting. I wonder if I have that. I don't know if I have that. I have... Oh, you're gonna see, though. You have the... Do you have a PBR one? Bro, you should buy one for me, bro. These are... These are gonna be cool. You're gonna have a pretty good set of stuff. I don't know. Ooh, Jones, smell it, blue. Consider it. I'll just sell it to you personally, Mist. I mean, like I said, I'm gonna count my overstock on Thursday and then see where we're at for that drop Friday. But hit me up if you want one. I got you, buddy. One cool thing to point out about this, actually, when I was setting this up, there was one thing I knew I wanted to put on this compilation, the very first one. And it's a song by Reverb Light. You guys have heard me talk about Reverb Light before. I had a Reverb Light tape on the last episode, and I'm gonna play this Reverb Light song. It is a part of a pair of songs, and I actually strung them together for this release. And it's called Holy Night, and it's just a great cut up and flip, originally released in 2013. And this is one of my favorite Vaporwave Christmas songs of all time. And so I asked Reverb Light if we could put it on this comp, and he was down, even though he has not been active in the scene for a couple years before this came out. I want to listen to this. I really love this song.
Silent night, holy night, if you keep me one more night, you're beginning a Christmas tea tonight.
Great song. I forget which Reverb Light album that's on. I want to say it's the B-sides, but maybe not. You should go check that out. Two really cool Christmas songs paired with each other that are just awesome tracks, and I put them as one track for this comp. So, it's a Vaporwave Christmas. You can still pick up some limited copies and go download online. A lot of people still download this year after year, and I hope it keeps getting some mileage, because I think when I originally did the first edition, it barely came out like the day before or after Christmas, and I was dubbing the tapes on my high-speed duplicator at home. I think these were also duplicated on that duplicator, but these were done a little bit earlier because I knew I was going to do this and the Oh Come All You Vapeful at the same time. So, some copies still available if you want. Next thing I'll move on to is a Sad Chassis album. This is pretty well known in the Vaporwave scene, and especially in the collector scene, as being one of the ultimate kind of Christmas tapes. It looks beautiful, the artwork is great, has an awesome Obi strip. There's a VHS version that goes with it. Ow. Oh, my VHS is upstairs. Here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna pull up the Sad Chassis, start playing it, and go get that VHS and use the restroom. And then I'll come back. Okay. There we go. Here is the VHS version. So, Sad Chassis. It's one of those kind of things a lot of people in the vaporwave scene have or collect. There's been a couple editions over the years. There's a couple different colors and variants of it as well. But it's fantastically well made, and I think the artists did it all themselves. I bought this 2 years ago? And I bought the VHS cassette package, and he made a whole video album for this. This is one of the OG Christmas video vaporwave kind of releases, along with Christmas at the Hyper Mall, which is a Blank Banshee thing. And gosh, when did this originally come out? 2017? Really? No. Regardless, it's pretty cool. It's got a bunch of different sections on it, and the artwork and packaging is fantastic. So, if we open this up, you can see it's got a 4-panel double-sided J-card. Unfortunately, the creasing's a little rough. I mean, I've had it for a while, but it's printed on that kind of like holographic-ish shiny paper, and so everything looks kind of like a bit shiny. It's a cool thing to do. You could do this if you just go buy the right kind of paper and print on it. Like, it's not that hard to do, but a lot of people just don't think about the type of paper you use when you are making your cassettes. If you remember last week, the Shaggy sample tape, that textured paper was so nice. It was such a cool linen paper, and it made for an amazing look when it was printed. This is the same way. Like, this kind of slightly shiny holographic paper looks really cool when printed on. It's definitely kind of like a novelty thing. You wouldn't want to do it for every release, and I imagine it's a little bit more expensive because you have to buy the sheets, but it does look very good. It looks very nice. It's in these like vanilla cream colored shells for your Norelco. I love that. That's just a really cool aesthetic for the release. Really makes it feel kind of old school. And just more great design. Great design work is just like paramount to having a nice release, you know? And this one, no doubt, looks fantastic. You can see a little bit of edge problems where they didn't take out the template, you can tell, and maybe they should have done a kind of a different design on the edge of the tape, but you try and do your best, and this is just bright red. Looks fantastic. I mean, can't argue. Nice old Obi strip, looks like they made it themselves and used glue stick. This is just the kind of way I do Obi strips. In fact, I think my first Obi strips are really inspired by this one, for my There was an early Wave Race 64 tape that had an OB that was a very like weird thin OB like this. Now when I make OBs, I tend to make them thicker than this. But this is a really nice one. You know, got all sorts of funny shit on it. Japanese, like you'd expect. Big logo from the label. Some other special things here. Just a good, solid release. A lot of people have bought and collected this over the years. The tape, really sick. I think he made these boxes himself, looking at the way that it's cut and folded, because this is also on very special paper, and the paper is also shiny for this. So I have a feeling he found a VHS template and printed on these boxes, and it just looks so good. Nice print on the print on the sticker here that's on the shell. The texture is really great. It looks like Ne touche pas la bande de vidéo. Are these originally like French VHS tapes? No, it says made in the USA here though. But yeah, got the spine, it's got the top. It's really everything you'd ask for in a VHS release. Full package. Fully fantastic package as well. So, I'm actually on the Bandcamp here. We've been listening to it in the background. And it looks like you could still buy. You could still buy some of this stuff. Oh, no, you can only buy the Betamax version. So there's a Betamax up there. It's even discounted at this point. God, it also looks fantastic. The design is so cool. But yeah, there's still two Betamaxes you could buy of this. No more tapes. No more VHS. So it says metallic paper. Use metallic. Wow. Yeah, sad chassis. Go buy the Betamax version. Maybe I'll do that just for shits and giggles. If they had a green one, I would consider it. Oh, we know it's blue. Just for the collection factor, I almost want to do it. I've now been collecting video stuff, so I don't know. Anyway, sad chassis. Home for the Holidays, a great Christmas release. And then I also have another Christmas classic. This is one of the definitely one of the standout Christmas albums that have been around in the vaporwave scene. An album made by a single artist. And that single artist is Mitro. So let's pull this up on Bandcamp so we can listen to this Mitro Christmas album. You might know Mitro for his Dragon Ball Wave series. He's done all those, I think, through Tiger Blood Tapes, and this album's done through Legendary Entertainment, which I think is a division of Tiger Blood Tapes, or is associated with Tiger Blood Tapes. I'm not sure. But this release is called Holiday Season. Let's start with Aspen Ski Lodge. I want to listen to it. Yeah, it's got like that Vapor House kind of vibe you'd expect from Mitro. Great album, for sure. I don't know how Christmassy it really is. I haven't listened to this, obviously, all year, because, like, why would I listen to this in the middle of the year? But maybe I should. This could be good for my upcoming set for our Virtual Memory Christmas show. I can look into this more. But yeah, I have the red glitter edition. As Miss said, there was a green glitter edition as well. And good looking. 2016 release. So I guess that would have been the same year, actually, as the Contemporary Tapes. No. Contemporary Tapes comp was in 2017. This is interesting. We're kind of hitting all the different years here that cool Christmas stuff has come out. Huh. Can anyone find anything from 2015 that was a good Christmas release? If there's some Christmas vaporwave from 2015, someone should let me know. You can kind of keep this running list of all the Christmas vaporwave stuff. I'll have to go back. There was an issue of Private Suite magazine that came out that was a Christmas issue, and Indie Advan did great research and kind of covered a lot of the Christmas albums that have existed. And one of my favorites, which unfortunately I heard was taken down from YouTube, was Christmas at the Hyper Mall. It's like a Blank Banshee thing. Christmas at the Hyper Mall is fucking awesome. I watch that every year for Christmas. I don't know if it was ever put on VHS or DVD, but if it's not on YouTube anymore, I need to find the video file somewhere, because that was like a legendary ass fucking thing. And so if you've never seen Christmas at the Hyper Mall, you should go try and find it. You should also listen to this Mitro Holiday Season. Very cool album. Cool Christmas release. Something that's part of my kind of Christmas collection, as I've kind of accumulated Christmas vaporwave over the years. Now being the guy that does the Christmas vaporwave album. Which, if you didn't know, we do have a Christmas vaporwave album that we are compiling for this year. In fact, I am going to... Let's put the little ad thing on screen. I made an image for it. I'm just going to do it. This might chop up the stream a bit, folks, but it'll be worth it. It's a cool flyer that I made to promote our Christmas album. Yeah, it's appropriate I talk about it and show it now before I show our Christmas compromise here. Okay, here it is. Pacific Plaza Christmas compilation. There's the info if you want to contribute. Sorry for the small ad break, y'all. Less than 4 minutes. Please stick to those genres. I don't want, like, an ambient song. That's just, we're not making that kind of compilation. I don't want a noise song. We're not making that kind of compilation. Unfortunately, like, if you're going to do Slush Wave, you're going to have to shorten it up so it's more like late night lo-fi. But yeah, there you go. There's information for this year's Christmas comp. Bye-bye. Well, I guess that takes us here. O Come All Ye Faithful. Adjust this a little. I haven't looked at the camera angle the whole show, but maybe I should have.
No.
So, last year, Incarta 95 was starting to put together a Christmas compilation, and I was like, yo, dude, that sounds sick as fuck. Why don't we work on this together? I can hit up some artists and help fill out the lineup that you've put together so far. And he was like, that's amazing, let's do this. And I was like, oh, yes, bless, like, thank you, like, I'm so stoked to work together. So Strudelsoft and Pacific Plaza Records collaborated to bring you this 18-track compilation from 2019 called O Come All Ye Vapeful. And it's got the iconic Santa hitting a jewel artwork made by Secret Schools, great artist who's done tons of stuff in the vaporwave scene over the years. You've definitely seen tons of his artwork and you don't even realize it. But I came up with this tagline, 18 tracks of holiday cheer from your favorite vaporwave artists. Unreleased tracks, live stream classics, and wacky takes on the Christmas canon. So the reason I said all these things is there was unreleased tracks. Live stream classics is a reference to Christmas stream that Wizard of Loneliness, 3D Blast, Nano Shrine, and Carta, all those guys did back a couple years ago, and it actually caused quite a kerfuffle on r/Vaporwave, if I remember correctly. And so Dan Mason's track, It's Christmas Time, and Nano Shrine's track, Notebook, were actually both on that live stream originally. And so it was kind of like cool to see those tracks actually being brought back for a real official release, especially in the Nano Shrine one, which kind of kicked off like a nice friendship with Nano that's grown a lot in the last year, basically, for me personally. And yeah, wacky takes on the Christmas canon. I mean, let's listen to the Wizard of Loneliness track. We're going to go back to Pacific Plaza's Bandcamp. Whoop, wrong Pacific. And holy crap. The Wizard of Loneliness track on here is so ridiculous. Like, when I first heard it, I was like, this is great. This is truly a wacky take on the Christmas canon. One other thing that was a wacky take that had nothing to do with Christmas was the Lord Pusswhip song. And I guess Encarta wanted to include Lord Pusswhip because of all the stuff he saw about him on the Econ streams, and then heard some of his music and saw how just like hilarious he was, and so invited him. And Lord Pusswhip did a collab with Zepeda called Cortex that sounds like it has nothing to do with Christmas, and it very much confused me when I first received the tracks, but hey, that's how it goes. And so there's Lord Pusswhip on this compilation if you're looking for rare Lord Pusswhip tracks. But yes, here is The Wizard of Loneliness, Santa's Boy. The song is weird and creepy.
True G. JC. Happy birthday, baby.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you, baby Jesus. It's the Christmas time of year. Everybody's spreading cheer. Let's hear it.
Yeah, check it. Here comes the Santa melody. Santa's on the roof. You can hear his footsteps, making his moves, getting down the gymnasts. Gonna give you the presents. I hope he got me something to replace those cookies that he's gonna take from me. I'm gonna see his jiggling belly. He laughs, he smiles, he pats me on the ass. That's the way I like my Santa doing it in class. I'm a Santa's bitch. I'm just a Santa's bitch.
Wow. Yes, this is where it starts to get a little sketch. But The Wiz, man. Whizzing all over everybody. So good. This compilation was really fun to put together. It was really cool kind of collaborating with secret schools to do some of these special elements. We decided, yeah, it should be NTSC because it's supposed to look like a game and a DVD and whatever other kind of media you think it might be. The Xbox element is very obvious. The spine, though, was also done like Xbox, which is fucking sick. And the text he used was just like 90s rave-ish, which is really great. You have your classic grid overlay, so very vaporwave. And on the back, we have our teen warning, and I actually came up with these things that come in the little box, where it says, plunderphonic language, super chill themes, and aesthetics. So, proud of that. Very cool. Fake barcode. It says 420, 1225. And then it says 028, which is the Pacific Plaza catalog number for it. So 420, Christmas Day, catalog number, and then 69 on the outside. So there's all sorts of little fun things on here like this. I really love that Secret Schools does that, and it's one of the things that I've tried to keep with my design aesthetic as well. So on the disc, we got a full, nice color disc, and it's glossy. This was actually printed by a CD company that no longer exists, that was in Southern California, that I used to use all the time back in the DIY days for making digipacks and nicely printed CDs to put in sleeves. They got COVID-ed and then they closed down. So now I have a new CD manufacturer. But they used to make really nice discs actually back in the day. So I drove out to their facility to pick up these discs because we did all the casing and stuff ourselves. It says, do not make illegal copies of this disc. I don't give a fuck. Dolby Digital, yeah, right. NTSC, sorta true. But the disc itself looks fantastic, like a great Xbox game disc. And then I made buttons, more of those wrapping paper buttons. There would also usually be a Pacific Plaza button in here and a candy cane. I'll probably reload these with that stuff for the new shipment. And then I got these nice things printed, a Christmas card. Just has the artwork. It says, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Sincerely, Strudel Soft and Pacific Plaza Records. This was a literal fucking template you could get at, like, a big corporate store, and I thought that was perfectly cheesy for this release. And when I sent these to the artists or to Encarta, I wrote nice notes, which was always fun to receive. And I found a Christmas charades game for a couple bucks at some store, and I think it was while I was trying to find stuff circuit bending when I first started getting into that at the end of last year, beginning of the 2020. I found a Christmas charades game, so I put one card from a Christmas charade game inside of each package. And it's usually a sticker. But yeah, this was an awesome release to do together. The track we're hearing right now is Visceral, aka Groovy Kaiju, collab he did with NetNavi. This year, Groovy Kaiju told me that he has another collab with NetNavi that's going to be on our comp, the digital one that we do this year. So yeah, that was our little Christmas segment here with all our Christmas Vaporwave releases. Hope you found some new stuff to listen to and put on your playlist for this year, and maybe got inspired to join the compilation that we're going to do yet again. And I want to just continue to do every year. So before I go into the bonus content, for people who are still watching on Periscope, or if you're hanging out on Twitter watching this, I encourage you to come over to Twitch for future episodes. I'm going to keep doing this every week, and I'm trying to have more regular streaming content on our Twitch channel. So for those of you who do sign up and subscribe, not only do you get the emojis, but there will be cool stuff happening. And I'm going to be trying to do more. I'm trying to host little shows occasionally. I'm doing more circuit bending stuff, and I'm doing a lot of video stuff. I'm currently trying to get set up with a capture card, and I'm waiting for all of the things to come in to get it going on Mac, which is tricky. But I'm really trying to be able to pick up composite stuff, do video games, and also have weird circuit bending projects and video bending projects that I can stream directly on to Twitch, like to live bending. So I'm trying to get that all worked out. I have a big setup right here where I've been working on and circuit bending a unit for a Glotto Grease from Pecari Sweat. I'm going to play around with that a little bit. All these poor tapes run out. I'm thinking I might end the stream just so we have our Tapes on Tuesday segment, and then I'm gonna come back and I think I might do some video circuit bending and just like visual stuff and just take one of these cameras and just point it at the TV since I don't have a capture card right now. So I kinda just wanna play with it for a little while. And you know, we've gone about an hour and a half, which is about how long I went last time, and then I did a little bit extra. So I think that's how I'm gonna do it today. And I'm gonna move on to some very last things. But not before showing off this awesome new tape, Super Sentai by Twin Pines Mall. This is going to come out on Friday. It is one of his more recent albums, and it's got some great tracks on it. It's on these really sick blue tapes, and you'll be seeing a lot more promo and little video clips and fun Sentai clips from the show that Super Sentai is named after, the Japanese version of Power Rangers, throughout the week. So stay on the lookout for that, and yes, there'll be a new Twin Pines Mall tape you can cop, and I believe the other old Twin Pines Mall tape we put out years ago, one of our first releases, might actually be fully sold out, I mean, except for mini CDs, but I made so many of those back in the day, an unreasonable amount back in the day. They'll be available for a while. But yeah, you can cop this new Twin Pines Mall on Friday for Bandcamp Friday. Very cool. I love orange and blue aesthetics. Go together so well. So yeah, this has been Tapes on Tuesday with Alex here on the Pacific Plaza Twitch channel. I've really been enjoying going through different stuff in my collection, and I got lots of weird things and tons of more tapes I could still go through and tell stories about and talk about. Today, we went through Daytime Kicks by Rez, Biosphere by Cobalt, Road, and Stack Overflow. What was it? Called Jiao Hong and Jiao Jiao Hong, a noise tape from China, purchased in China. Ihi Cool Drinks Unlimited, Casual Friday, their 2014 demo. Tough Stuff's EP College. Pacific Plaza, It's a Vaporwave Christmas, our very first Christmas comp. Mitro, Holiday Season, Christmas Future Punk album. Sad Chassis, a classic Christmas Vaporwave release that y'all should definitely go check out, and I'm pretty sure you can watch the video album on YouTube. And of course, Come All You Vapeful, last year's Pacific Plaza / Strudelsoft co-release compilation. So that's all the stuff I went through today. I hope you guys enjoyed listening to it, and I hope you enjoyed me talking about it. If you want to stick around here at the end, I'm going to do one more little segment about these things. It is a CD and a cassette. But if you don't want to stick around, fine, be that way. But yes, Tuesday, every Tuesday at 7 p.m. on Periscope / Twitter and twitch.tv/ Pacific Plaza. I'm going to be doing Tapes on Tuesday with Alex, going through my collection of cassette tapes, and also showing off some other cool physical media ephemera. and also showing off weird releases and weird packaging like these things. I haven't listened to these in years. I might have not ever have listened to this, but these are weird things I got probably in 2009, 2010. Maybe we'll figure that out as I go through them, but this is a cassette tape in a hand-sewn package on a Maxell 90-minute tape by Growth Spurt. Growth, S-P-E-R-T. And on the other side it says Dorks. No idea why. Not been able to find an insert. I'm not sure if an insert came with this. But I'm pretty sure I know where this came from, and I'm pretty sure I got it at the same time I received this, which is a CD by Unavi. I'm gonna turn down the music in the background. This is not the music from this release. I cannot find these releases, and I'm not even gonna bother to try. But these are weird folk and punk releases from like about 2009, 2010, 2008 probably. And I got these on tour after my band, Your Yellow Dress, played at and stayed at a punk house in Salt Lake City, Utah, called the Boeing Collective. I mentioned the Boeing Collective, I'm pretty sure, on my last show. And this is some of the craziest and most interesting physical packaging I have in my collection. And it's just weird stuff. Now, obviously we see this tape, it's a Maxell 90-minute tape, old school style tape, really cool, with some sort of release called Grow by Growth Spurt. Who knows? I don't know. In the future, I think I want to get a Walkman and see if I can plug it up to an audio interface, and then maybe we could listen to some of these things directly off tape in the future. I think that could be really cool, but for now we can't. And for now, we will never know what is on this Growth Spurt tape. Now, the reason why I'm pretty sure I know what this is, or know where I got it, is because it is connected with this Unavi CD, and I did get them from the same guy at a punk house in Salt Lake City. And I remember he booked us a show at that punk house, and we also stayed there on another occasion, but he wasn't living there on that occasion. That would have been like a year later. I'm pretty sure I booked a show that he played the Bay Area. I can't remember exactly what the show was or who else would have played it, but I think his name was James, and he was about my age, and he was, or maybe a year or two older, and he was a crust punk, basically. He was a folk punk, crust punk, traveler kind of kid whose main base of operation was out of a collective house in Salt Lake City called the Boeing Collective, and we traded for these releases. I'm pretty sure I traded him a Your Yellow Dress CD that was a crazy hand-sewn package as well. And this is the CD. This was the tape that you already saw. The CD has twine. The twine is wrapped around another piece of twine that is stuck through the case. That is anchored around a piece of wood. Now, if I remember, this kid was into woodworking. And so I'm pretty sure he probably cut all these little nuggets of wood for this release. So when you unwrap it, right here, these cardboard pieces kind of open up. And it looks like this cardboard was taken from bottom of a case of bottles. You can see bottle outlines on it. Really weird stuff. This cardboard was clearly not meant to be folded like this, but it looks like it's pretty thick and stocky, and that's why he would have used it. And yeah, you can see he just tied a knot on this end of the twine, and then tied a knot on this end of this piece of wood, which he drilled a hole through. And the stopper is what we wrap our other piece of twine around. He did the same thing here. We just tied a knot. And your CD, which, ironically enough, it's a full-printed color CD, professionally made somewhere, is in here. And it's not a sticker. It's not stuck onto it. It's printed on here. It says Unavi the Wilderness. It's pretty scratched up now. Not quite sure if it would work upon playing, but it's definitely like folky folk punk music. This kid like played banjo and had friends that did washboard and stuff like that, mandolins. And yeah, these were two of his releases. Don't know whatever happened to him. Don't know much about him anymore, but he was, you know, a scrappy crust punk traveler kind of kid. And he just did whatever he needed to do to make these releases come together, you know? And this just cardboard from something wrapped around. Like, you know, it's not even like a fancy package. It's just kind of like interesting and thrifty. It's literally twine, wood, and cardboard. And it doesn't really do the job well. But I've always kept it since he traded this to me. And I'm sure at the time I was really, like, smitten with this. And I probably even listened to the CD back in the day, especially on tour when we would just have really long drives for, like, 6 hours at a time. And you would just would listen to whatever music people gave you at the shows, whether it was other local bands or other just kids at the show. And sometimes you'd stumble on gems. Sometimes you would listen to that release over and over. There was a... Was it a tape? Tape by a band that we got on tour in 2017. And it was a CD. We listened to that CD hundreds of fucking times. We ended up learning all the lyrics to this weird, obscure, nobody band from New Hampshire songs. And it was fucking sick. But yeah, this is The Wilderness by Unavi. You can see here on the case, he stamped it with letters. And he stamped it in the cardboard. Just... thrifty, interesting, weird, cool. Something I'm very glad to have. This is a bonus for the Tapes on Tuesday segment. And I hope you guys really like this and this just funky ass cassette release. I do have a lot of weird cassettes that are in either hand sewn packages, weird cardboard packages, basically non-Norelco packaging. And, you know, this Tough Stuff tape was an example of that, non-Norelco packaging. And this Grow tape, by Growth Spurt. Hand sewn in the jankiest of ways. Very cool. Very unique. Something you're only ever gonna find by going on a weird underground DIY tour and sleeping in nasty cat piss smelling punk houses. So, good little bonus segment for our Tapes on Tuesday. Hope everyone enjoyed. Wow, of course! I keep kicking on this fucking drum stool. I keep kicking this. And that's why it keeps falling. So I'm gonna stand here for the end. I'm gonna enable preview so I can see myself. Say thanks everybody for joining me. Hope you like this Tapes on Tuesday segment. I'll be back next week with some more crazy shit. Some vaporwave stuff, some non-vaporwave stuff, some punk stuff, some emo stuff, some indie stuff, some DIY stuff. All sorts of good things. Tuesday nights. 7 p.m. Pacific. Tapes on Tuesday. Come hang out. If you have cool stuff that you want to show me, or if you have weird releases or weird formats or weird packaging, show me on Twitter. Send me a tweet. Tag me at Pacific Plaza. And I'm going to end this stream here for like 60 seconds. That way I have this as a concrete segment. And then I'm going to move my cameras and computer over here to where I have a TV set up with my visual stuff that I've been circuit bending for Picari Sweat. So I'm going to end the stream for a bit here, move my gear quickly, and then I'm going to jump back on, and I'm just going to fuck around with this for a while, and if anyone wants to stick around and watch it, you're more than welcome to. So thanks you guys so much. I'll see you later. In like 30 seconds.